Hello, I'm Bob, and this is the Home Bitcoin Immersion Mining Channel. In this build series episode, I'm going to cover the setup and startup of an Antminer S21 Bitcoin miner. So with that, let's get started. But before getting on with the video, I want to mention some sponsors of the channel, the first being Brains. When you step up beyond a home setup and start to run more than just a couple miners, managing your entire mining fleet can be a challenge. And this is where the Brains Toolbox is an essential tool. The Brains Toolbox allows you to have a top-down look at every miner in your farm. You can start and stop miners, update miner firmware, and adjust configuration and performance settings. You can make changes on a miner-by-miner basis or do batch operations across subsets or your entire mining fleet. The software has a great UI, but it also has extensive command line input capabilities. And best of all, it's free. So if you're ready to start managing your mining setup like a pro, the Brains Toolbox is ready and waiting for you. Now my next sponsor is Scott's Crypto Mining and the Build-A-Mine Bootcamp. In the Build-A-Mine Bootcamp, you'll learn everything you need to know to launch your first megawatt of Bitcoin miners in less than 3 months. The Build-A-Mine Bootcamp is taught by Scott himself, and you'll be joined by other entrepreneurs and business owners like you who want to learn how to stack more sats faster through Bitcoin mining on an industrial scale. To get in on this fantastic opportunity, just click the link in the description below. And last up is the mining hardware supplier for the channel, Altair Bitcoin Mining Solutions. Altair is your one-stop shop for any mining hardware you might need. They have everything from the latest and greatest miners to every hashboard, cable, and part you might need to repair your existing hardware or build your own 120-volt home-built miner. Altair has years of experience working in the Bitcoin mining industry, running their own mining farm, and they've worked with all different scales of mining operations. Altair is based in the US and has top-rated customer support. And so if you have any question about anything at any time, they are there to help you out. Altair is a huge supporter of the home mining community, so if you're looking to buy your next miner or miner parts for your home setup, check out their website at the link below. You'll find pretty much everything you'll ever need. Okay, so as I've covered in past episodes, I've been heating my water, my house, and my garage with two S19J Pro miners. They've been running great, providing plenty of heat for my home, and I'm earning Bitcoin along the way. My plan was to keep running with them, but I needed another miner for my latest Bitcoin dryer build project, so I swapped out one of my S19s for that project, and I got a brand new S21 miner. And if you're interested in how my Bitcoin dryer project went, I have a link below to that playlist. But the focus of this episode is to get my S21 miner up and running. Now, even if you are not using immersion cooling and are instead using air cooling, the initial setups are going to be the same, so this video should work for anyone with an S21 miner. Now, I got my S21 miner from my sponsor and hardware provider, Altair Bitcoin Mining Solutions. They've been a great partner and super helpful with picking out the right hardware for my builds. They recommended I go with the 188 terahash model since it's a bit cheaper, and down the road with aftermarket firmware, I'll likely be able to overclock it and run it at higher speeds comparable to the more expensive S21 models. Now, when you get a brand new Bitmain miner, the first step is to get them out of the box and inspect them to make sure they are ready to start. The goal here is to open the miner up and check that nothing drastic has happened to the miner during shipping. This is recommended by Bitmain and something you really should do before hooking the miner up to power. Now, the first step in taking the miner apart for inspection is to remove the control board cover. On the back of the miner, loosen the single screw securing the cover button. Next, press the metal button while pulling up on the cover and it should release from the miner housing. Pull the cover off and set it aside. Next, remove the metal cover on top of the power supply by first pulling back the fan wire a bit and then removing the two screws located on the back of the cover. The cover then slides back and off the miner. With the cover off, you can check the control board power and data cable connections to the PSU to make sure the connectors are in place. Next, remove the four screws attaching the backplate assembly to the miner housing. It's best to start at the bottom, and these bottom two screws are a little tricky to reach around the fans. It's really helpful to have the miner extend off the end of a table or ledge to get access here. And with the four screws off, rotate the back assembly out of the way. Next, remove the six screws attaching the power bus bars to the hashboards. And for all of these screws, don't lose them. They are tiny and really easy to misplace. As you can see, I found it works really well to use the hashboard cover to hold my screws when I'm working on my miners. Next, detach the three ribbon cables from each of the hashboards. And once this is done, the three hashboards are now completely disconnected from the miner and ready to be removed and inspected. Now, when inspecting the hashboards, you really don't need to be an expert here. Just pull out each board one at a time and take a quick look. We're looking for something really obvious like a heatsink, capacitor, or other component that is obviously loose, damaged, or has fallen off. If you do find something wrong, return your miner or get it fixed before turning it on. After each board is inspected, put them back in place and just reverse the previous assembly steps. Connect the hashboard cables. Attach the power bus screws. Rotate the back plate assembly back into place and use the four small screws to attach the back plate assembly onto the miner housing. Reattach the power supply cover and the two screws holding it in place. And the final reassembly step is to reattach the hashboard cover. Now, the last step is to attach the power cords to the miner, and this is where I really like the changes Bitmain has made in the S21 model. Instead of the two C14 receptacles needing two cords that you had to provide in the old S19, the S21 only needs a single connection, and the miner comes with its own cord. The miner end of the cord has a fairly unusual Anderson-type connector, and the other side is a standard C20 connector. Now, these miners need 240-volt power, and the circuit powering the miner should be able to handle at least 20 amps under normal operation. And if you are planning to overclock, you'll want that circuit to handle at least 25 amps or more, depending on how hard you plan on running the miner. As always, before starting up any of these high power systems, get help from a qualified electrician to inspect your wiring, your plugs, your breakers, and all other parts of your infrastructure to ensure they can handle these higher power loadings. Now, before starting up the miner, there are a few things to do. First, grab a set of earplugs. You're going to be working around your miner for a while, and the fan noise on the S21s is even louder than the S19s, and you want to be comfortable while you're working around your miner. Second, you'll want to pick your mining pool and go through whatever registration and setup steps you need to do on that pool's website. I covered picking your pool in a past episode if you want more information on how mining pools work. The third and final step to take before starting the miner for the first time is to download a couple pieces of software. First, you'll need to download the latest copy of the S21 firmware. This is needed because miners can often be stored for long times by the manufacturer or by the distributors, and so more often than not, the stock firmware on your miner will be out of date. Just load the Bitmain website, select Customer Support, and go to Firmware Download. Select the SHA-256 hashing algorithm, select your miner hardware, and download the firmware to a folder of your choice. Also, while on this page, the other piece of software to download is the IP Reporter. Select Others and IP Reporter and download this to your folder. With all that prep work done, the next step is to connect the miners to Ethernet and power and get them running. Now, even if you are intending to use immersion cooling, it still is a really good idea to run everything in stock configuration for a few hours to make sure everything runs correctly before removing the fans and dunking the miner in dielectric fluid. Now, Bitmain miners do not support Wi-Fi, so you will need a direct cable connection to an Ethernet port. If your mining location is away from an Ethernet port, I recommend using the Vonage Model VAP11G-300 Wi-Fi bridge. It's fairly inexpensive, and it has worked really well on my past projects. Now, with Antminer miners, there isn't a power on or off button. As soon as you hook up the cables and provide power, the miner will start running. It will go through its startup sequence, spooling the fans up and down, and then it will settle into a low power standby mode. As I said before, the S21 is super loud. Earplugs are really handy here. In the initial standby mode, the miner will only be pulling a little over 1 amp of current, and you'll see the red fault light is on. This is normal. The fault light is on because you haven't logged in yet, and the miner isn't connected to a mining pool. Next, run the Antminer IP reporter software that was downloaded earlier. You'll need to right-click and run this as an administrator to make this work correctly. After it is up and running, click the Start button, which will make the software start searching for your miner on your home network. Next, while this is running, walk over to your miner and press and hold the IP report button on the miner for about 5 seconds. This will get your miner to send out its IP information to be found by the software. After a little while, the software should find your miner. You'll see an IP address and MAC address for your hardware. Copy that IP address into a web browser to connect to your miner, and when asked for a username and password, enter root for both. This will get you logged into the miner dashboard page. Now, the first thing you'll want to do here is to change your password so no one else can log in and change your miner setup. Click on System and Password, enter the old and your new passwords, and hit save. And a quick side note, if you ever forget your password, you can always press the reset button on the back of your miner. This will delete all setup information and return the password to the default root. The next step is to change the miner IP configuration settings, and this is totally optional. Hit IP settings to go to the IP configuration settings window. By default, the miner is set up for DHCP, so if you want to change this to a static IP address, here is your chance. And you can also change your host name here if you want. Next up is updating the miner firmware. Click System and then Firmware Upgrade. Find the firmware file you downloaded earlier and hit Update to start the update process. This will take a couple minutes and the miner will automatically restart as part of the firmware update. During this time, you do not want to unplug or mess with your miner. If the firmware gets corrupted, you could mess up your miner so that it won't run at all. Just be patient, let the software do its thing. The last step in setting up your S21 is to connect your miner to your mining pool. From the dashboard page, select Settings. Here, copy over the mining address, miner name, and password as directed by your mining pool website. After entering this data, hit save. After saving your pool information, your miner will automatically connect to your pool and start mining. Now, this initial connection and ramp-up process will take a little time, maybe as much as 10 to 15 minutes. Again, be patient and just let the software run. You'll know when your miner has started mining Bitcoin by either watching the Antminer dashboard or any current meter you might have on the power input to your miner. When your miner is running, you should see the hash rate on the dashboard, and you should also see the current draw for your miner ramp up substantially. Now, if you are air cooling your miner, this is the end of your miner setup. Your miner will keep finding mining shares and Bitcoin hashes and sending them onto your pool, earning you your Bitcoin payout. However, if you are using immersion cooling, you want to keep your miner running like this for another few hours to make sure there's nothing wrong. And if everything is still running well after a few hours, the miner has passed its initial checkout and is ready for immersion. And the next steps to prep an S21 miner for immersion operation are covered here.